Welcome,
Young Jerks.
We are every Saturday
on
PM
six
on EMF Radio, WEMF Radio
.com.
Look at us, we're so funny, Frankie. We're like a comfortable shoe. We're just comfortable.
You know
who we are. We're the Young Jerks. Every Saturday, we get into a real talk about politics. Usually, lately, especially with this election.
Always talking about politics. And big announcement right now.
Is it a big announcement? I mean, think people already know.
They probably do already know.
But it's a good thing for us. I mean, we're going to have him on for the fourth time now. Candidate running for governor.
Evan Falchuk.
And he's already on the line. And I don't even think he needs an introduction anymore on this show. And just for the campaign in Massachusetts. And even nationally, I was talking to some of my friends from New Jersey today. And they knew the name, Evan Falchuk. They're aware of him. Evan, welcome to the show. Thank you for calling in today.
Thanks. That's really nice to hear people in Jersey talking about me. You guys have a reach.
you have a reach. I think, you know, we've been talking about this for a while, that your campaign is doing better than the pundits have been saying, and specifically bringing up these issues, and people are really starting to notice it. They're noticing that Coakley and Baker, it's like, does anyone really want to vote for either one of these folks? How do you feel right now, the weekend before this big election? How are your spirits? How are you feeling right now, today?
I feel great. I mean, today we were out in Quincy and Braintree and also in Boston meeting voters. I was outside a supermarket in Quincy. That's just a great place to meet people. Got in a lot of conversations. I don't think there was a single person out of the dozens and dozens I met that hadn't heard of what we were doing. And most of them, almost all of them, were saying, I'm voting for you. And they, what they believe in is the same thing that we've been talking about this entire campaign, which is that we've got a political establishment that is not representing people, that is representing corporate interests and big money, and that it won't change from the inside, that neither Charlie Baker nor Martha Coakley are offering that. The article that was in the Globe today, that Joanna Weiss did a profile on the campaign, and it said, Evan Falchuk's mission was the headline. And it's worth reading. What's interesting is think about replacing it. Think about replacing that headline to say Charlie Baker's mission or Martha Coakley's mission. You really couldn't think of what that mission would be about for either of them. Whereas for us, it's about saying we got to change the political process. We've got a detailed plan to reduce the cost of living, deal with the rising cost of health care, find ways to make sure people can get housing, and to make sure we can fill our legislature with people that want to do the people's business. That is a mission, and that's something worth voting for. And so when people go to vote on November 2nd, November 4th, and it's really important that they vote. I mean, that's so huge. Vote for change. Vote for a cause larger than just one candidate. That's what we're representing.
Yeah, I mean, you've worked so hard in this campaign. We can see it. How you're on everything. I can tell, not a media request that hasn't been answered. You've done them all, one after another, and done so well and so quick to just offer your real response and the issues that you've talked about months ago on this show and repeatedly through this campaign. Partners, health care, the cost of living. People, it's not just like we talk about marijuana a lot on this show, but for us and our audience, those are the issues they're bringing up, the things that you've been talking about. I mean, how can they ignore it now? It's just so obvious. How do you feel about these issues going forward? Do you think that people are actually going to demand this action, from their...
We have to. We have to work on them. As you know full well, if you believe in a cause, you got to keep advocating and keep working and persevering. And, you know, the issues that we've been talking about, particularly the things that have to do with the cost of living, affect everybody, and especially younger people, but also older people too. And they affect everybody who wants to make a living here in Massachusetts and find that they can't find a place to live in they can afford, or if you want to start a business that it's too expensive to try to do it, or just to be able to hold down a good job and maybe be able to save a little bit of money, or to be able to pay off student loans or afford to go to school. We aren't hearing candidates talk about this stuff because they don't really have answers to it. So some of what we see, and a lot of this to me is all opportunity, is when you don't hear people willing to engage on the issues that voters really care about, it means that there's a space for someone to come in and actually do it. So what we're seeing with with founding the United Independent Party and the Falchuk for Governor campaign is what happens when you run a political campaign and you're just real. You're just talking to people in direct ways where the issues that really matter to them. None of this is easy. I knew from the beginning they'd be throwing all kinds of roadblocks in front of us, and there's a lot of them, and more of them than I thought would be. But the end of the day, we're still good. We're still here, and we're not going away. And this is how we bring about real, meaningful change.
And working hard, too, you know. I visited your campaign office yesterday to pick up some signs, and, you know, you had the place was packed full of people making phone calls. You know, you were in the war room. You were working out the schedule for the final stretch. And I mean, these people are going to have to deal with you, right? You're gonna be here for quite some time, and the United Independent Party is going to be here for quite some time.
Yeah, we were glad to see it, and I can tell you that was not an incredibly busy day in the office. Most people were out in the field as they are now, knocking on doors, making sure people are aware. And you're right, we aren't going away, and that's what's so powerful about this, because it has been increasingly drawing people in when they see the possibility of building this new party, building this new platform. And we're also working to win this election. You know, everybody has to get out there and vote. You can't be told like what people are being told. I've been amazed at things I've been hearing out there as a candidate when you get to meet voters for real. So let me tell you about some conversations I've had in the last few days. I've had so many that are like this, where people say, a vote for you is a vote for Martha Coakley, or a vote for you is a vote for Charlie Baker.
Haven't I heard that? I've heard it too.
I keep hearing it. And I'm like, it's if you knew how many people on both sides feel that way, it's amazing. And you say, well, why don't you just vote the way you think is right? Why don't you vote for who you think is the best candidate? But it tells you something that people are being told that. It's the kind of ways to suppress turnout. I had a woman tell me over a couple of days ago, and this isn't the first time I've heard it, that she's being told by people that you can't vote for an independent on election day if you're registered in the Democratic or Republican parties. And that's just that's false. Everybody gets the same ballot, and you can vote whoever you want to vote for, and it's between you and the machine that's going to suck in your ballot. No one's going to know that it's you. You vote your conscience. But there's people being told these things. Every time I hear those stories, I say, all right, we're making more progress. We're making more progress. People are doing everything they can to keep our voters from turning out and voting the way they think is right.
It's the only thing they have left. It's the only thing that other side has left. I swear to God, it's like we need to get through to people that your vote counts, because it really does count. And I know this. And a vote for Falchuk is worth like 100 votes compared to anyone else on the ballot.
And it comes down to the fact that that's just, you know, the same kind of old adage. Well, you can't fight City Hall. It's either going to be the Republican or the Democrat, you know. Can't fight City Hall. And every time I talk to folks that, you know, I work with, you know, my buddies, I was just having a conversation with about, you know, why he should vote for you, for Evan Falchuk. And that same exact thing comes up every single time. Well, you know, I mean, then someone else is going to get in there that I don't like. And it's like, well, no. If everybody just voted what they wanted, they would get what they want.
That's right.
I mean,
well, you know, part of so much of what's happened in our politics over the last decade, and this is really part of what motivated me to get involved in this, was the fact that people say that and just don't realize that the majority of people actually feel as if the system's not representing them. The trouble is, because the political space has been so filled by people that are extreme in one way or another, you get the impression that if you feel like, geez, I just want to hear intelligent conversation and I want to have thoughtful answers and no sound bites on all these topics, but I must be alone because no one else feels that way. Because every time I watch TV and hear them talk about politics, there's never thoughtful conversation. Of course, if they're listening to your show, they hear it every time. But so many voters don't know it. And it's very powerful to be able to tell people, you know what, you're not alone. And that feeling of belonging to something that is bigger than yourself and bigger than just one candidate, bigger than just one election, that is powerful stuff. And of course, that's the kind of thing that is, you know, there's people that try to suppress. But the issues that we talk about aren't going away. You know, whatever anyone says or does or tries to tear down what we're doing, it doesn't change the fact that you've got partners monopolizing the healthcare market and driving up everybody's costs. It doesn't change the fact that there's no plan for producing more housing in Massachusetts. It doesn't change the fact that students are going deeper and deeper into debt because the state's not providing 8. It doesn't change the hundreds of millions of dollars in tax breaks going out to big companies and the lack of tax breaks going to small businesses. None of that changes because that's not what people want to talk about, but those are the issues that people deal with. That's what we're fighting for.
And so with that, like on that same vein, in light of the fact that we just found out that Massachusetts has had the highest spike in homelessness, right, in the whole mm-hmm. entire country over, since 2006, I believe.
Yeah, people who work full-time oftentimes can't even afford to rent and live here.
And that's what Evan's been talking about this whole entire time. That's what you've been talking about, Evan, this whole entire time, the cost of housing, yeah. the cost of living.
Healthcare.
And healthcare,
how many people get bankrupt because of healthcare? I mean, I look at my situation. I've rebounded, but a lot of situations, have been caused for a lot of people because of healthcare.
Yeah. And then what does it come down to? Evan, when was the last time that you cried?
I know.
That's what the election comes down to.
I think Brad actually answered for...
He did.
He did. He answered online. I saw that.
My brother's a genius.
He is. I got to tell you, the other thing I'm trying to lobby people on is that show, that American Horror Show, the Twisty the Clown. Oh, my God. I've been watching that show. Our family loves it, by the way. Just have to let you know. Yeah, it's a great show.
I mean, it is what it comes down to, is you see these things. And when was the last time you cried? I mean, think about this. I was talking to an audience today. This was police officers. In Boston, and the issues they were worried about had to do with funding for education, obviously public safety because they're police officers. Healthcare costs are a big deal both for them as individuals and for the departments that they work for. Housing, both because of the communities that they police, oftentimes are dealing with housing issues and because of where they live themselves. But when we talked about the fact that in these debates, the ones that I wasn't in, we found out the answer to who Martha thinks Charlie should be in for Halloween, who they think should play each other in a movie, who cooks and cleans around the house.
Who smoked weed.
Right. Yeah, who smoked pot.
Yeah, not where they stand on weed, but, this is the ridiculous things. Like, we don't even, it's just silly.
And it's ridiculous. And in a world in which there are serious problems going on, to have that kind of conversation happening is amazing. And then to actually try to exclude people from that kind of conversation is even more amazing. But you know what the worst part of it is that to me, the candidates sitting there being asked questions like that should be the kind of people that look at a reporter asking that kind of question and say, you should be ashamed of yourself. You know, let's talk about the real stuff, because at this point in the debate, there's been no conversation about healthcare or housing or all the other issues that I just talked about. But that's what gets lost. And of course, I saw a speaker the other night, a very smart woman, and she was talking about many of the things that we see going on in our politics. She said, this is a really sophisticated form of voter suppression. It's not the kind of voter suppression where you say, I'm going to actively try to keep someone from showing up to vote or trick them into not voting. But this kind of way of treating people with such disrespect that they say, forget it, I'm not going to participate in politics. And they know full well that the ads that they're putting on create that. They know full well that the way that they don't engage on any real issues makes people not want to vote. And that's part of their business model. This is what keeps the political establishment in business. People voting is the most dangerous thing they can do. And that's why they don't want you to do it. So what is so disruptive about the United Independent Party and the Falchuk for Governor campaign is that we're telling people, go, please vote. Please vote. We want you to vote. We may disagree on issues. You may not end up voting for me, but I want to see out there voting. I think more often than not, the people that are going to get out there to vote who wouldn't otherwise vote are going to vote for the Falchuk for Governor campaign. But either way, you got to participate in our democracy in order to make it function properly. And right now we got a democracy that is not functioning right.
It's so true. And like Bill Belichick would do, or Bill Parcells, when he's facing a reporter that asks a stupid question, you just tell him. And that's what I like about you, Evan. They asked you, the follow-up even to these debates were in the media, the David Bernstein, let's ask these silly questions. Let's talk about these silly questions. That's the model that they have now. Like, they ask you about coffee. And when the Boston Globe asked you about coffee,
you
talked all about the issues. You killed it. You killed it.
Thank
and they still got mad at you because you wanted to talk about the issues.
We want to talk about coffee.
It was amazing because the Boston Globe, I mean, for those of you that are listening that don't know what Mike's talking about, this was amazing.
Yeah.
So we got this note, and this was from the Boston Globe. It actually came from the Washington Bureau. So this is supposed to be the hardcore part of the paper. And they had a whole list. They said, we want to figure out the coffee drinking habits of the candidates for governor. And I saw it, and there were a whole list of questions. And I really honestly thought it was a joke when I first saw it, because there were questions like, when do you have your first cup of coffee? And
how many?
Buy it.
Yeah.
How many?
Do you go to Dunk's?
Do Reese's know you?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. It was ridiculous.
And I was like, wow, like you have to respond, because if you don't respond, then you're not included. And so I want to be included. But at the same time, it's ridiculous. It's just ridiculous. So I thought, well, you know what? Actually, a guy who works with me, Tom Householder, who did his immediate reaction was, you know what you should do? Talk about policy issues in here. You know, they're going to give you a platform. Do it. And I was like, that's a great idea. So they said, when do you have your first cup of coffee? Well, in the morning, I have one at home before I go out to talk to people about the urgent need for political change in Massachusetts.
Yeah.
It said, do you like to drink it in a coffee shop, or where do you like to go? And I'm like, well, I'm always out on the road. And when I'm out there, I talk to people about housing costs, and coffee shops can be great places to describe our thriving communities action plan and the fact that other candidates don't have even a plan on these issues. And that can surprise people. That to me was using the opportunity to talk about important issues, but it tells you something about where we are in our media, where that isn't what happens. But here's the thing, which is amazing, is that there are so many more outlets in which people can get information. You know, think about what you guys are doing. 10 years ago, this kind of programming isn't wasn't as mainstream as it is now.
Yeah, we wouldn't be able to do it. We wouldn't be able to do it. We wouldn't have this access. It's amazing what is happening.
Yep. So these old institutions, the newspapers and other things, they, you know, they obviously have an important platform. But, you know, increasingly what's been happening, like in everything else, is that it gets disrupted. It gets disrupted by the Internet, gets disrupted by people that say, why do I have to beg and plead for a newspaper or a radio station to provide me access? I'll just do it myself. And this is in an interesting way, and I was describing this, I was on with a radio host yesterday, who's a fairly conservative guy, because he said, why would you even do this? You know, why would you want to do this? You're making things more complicated than they need to be. And I said, this is the most American thing anybody can do. You know, I see a system that's not working right, and you, as an entrepreneur, try to create something, and trying to get people to be involved politically and get them to vote, that's American. That's American. And this gentleman, who's is a conservative, he didn't really have much of an answer to that, because that's, you know, he's probably got an American flag pinned on his jacket lapel. But it is an American thing to do, to organize for political change. It is an American thing to do, to advocate with other people for the causes you believe in. And that's what founded our country, and that's what's going to create this revival of our democratic process, by having a platform to have lots of new smart candidates to get in and to get into our legislature and to bring about positive change.
And that's what you do, and that's why we're so glad that you're out there fighting for all of us, and that this community has found each other, and we're all working together now, and we're going to have a united independent party after Tuesday, after everyone votes for Evan Falchuk. And
so that's cool.
People need to get out there and vote. And vote early, vote often, I don't care.
That's right, vote early, vote often.
But what can people do, though? This is the stretch run. What can people do to help your United Independent Party get to this 3%? It's a big number. If you get there, you get official party recognition, ballot access. How can we get this done on Tuesday? But how can we do it, Evan?
There's a lot people can do. As you said, vote, most important. Tell 10 of your friends. 10 of your friends, each one of you listening, 10 of your friends that they got to get out there and vote, and call them to make sure on Tuesday that they've voted. Call them. Have you voted yet? Have you voted yet? This is what we're going to be doing all day on Tuesday, and each one of your listeners that cares about this, they got to find 10 friends that will do that too. Social media, great way to do that also, but be active. Take responsibility for getting people out there to the polls. Also, if you want to go and do work at the polls, write an email into contact@falchuk2014.org. That's contact@falchuk2014, falchuk2014.org. We will set you up. And we will have literally hundreds of people all across the Commonwealth at polls throughout the day on Tuesday.
WEMF Radio.com. WEMF Radio.